Dr. Nesia Lang. Dr. Lang is a gynecologist. I think she was one of the first female gynecologists in Israel. Yeah, one of, I didn't say the one. Okay. She is the best. She told me not to say it, but it's not me. I didn't say it. Yes. She founded the Tene Center for Sexually Abused Children in Poria Hospital. And she just recently was awarded by Rappaport Prize, yeah, which is a very valued prize in Israel for her life work. So,
thank you very much. I am happy to be here, and at first I want to tell you that my English is not so good, so I hope you will understand all what I am going to tell you. Rachel asked me to speak about the medical examination of the alleged victimized children, the dilemmas that we have, the staff which have to examine the children, and the difficulties that come around with these special cases. This is the tennis center in Tiberias, near the lake of Kinneret, and it is in the grounds of the medical center, in the grounds of the Poria Medical Center, and this is the building that we specialize for the children and the parents who come and get a talk and a examination, documentation, and all the medical treatment they need. The task of being a member of the medical center for the sexually abused is not so easy. I was the only doctor, the medical doctor in this center, and I had to be available for 24/7 all the year, and it's not so easy in the evenings, in the nights, and to be available, and sometimes to have phone calls during the night, and you can't sleep later then on, and your husband can't sleep, and you awake with a heartbeat. What will I hear now on the phone? What kind of case? And you have to be qualified and learn. I went to United States to learn about all this, how to do it, and how to do it without harming the children. To do it delicately and professionally. This place is a quiet place in order to let the people enter without being seen by all the members of the hospital. The attitude is non-judicial because people, after being sexually abused, or the family that some members of the family was abused, would like to be in a discreet place and not a judicial one. The most important thing is to do a non-traumatic examination, because we don't want to re-traumatize the children who have been abused. And sometimes it will not be easy, because we have to look and to illuminate the place and to touch and to take samples. So sometimes the children wouldn't like to come, wouldn't like to enter, and it makes a lot of difficulties. And we have to let them. We don't do any force. We don't examine by force. We have to examine with the children when they are calm on the bed and accept to be examined. And also the documentation is not so easy, because you have to take pictures and you have to take samples from these parts that have been assaulted. It's not easy. Also, we are reaching out to the community in order to that the community will know about this center and will send children from the educational system, from the social welfare system, and from the medical system, which sometimes don't see and or don't want to see that abuse is being done. We have made also a preventive community projects in order to let children, especially 4 to 7 years old children, project for prevention of sexual abuse by a play, which name is Secret That Have to Be Told. With Rachel, we did some research, and we have a research coordinator, which makes a very, very special research. It's the first place where the research has been done. This is the children's bed. We made the facility to be nice, and the children would like to go above this bed. And we have in the staff, besides the nurse, besides the secretary, and the social workers and the volunteers, we have also medical clowns who helps us a lot and changed our all the attitude and all the work that we are doing. It changed and made it possible to check the children without a traumatic sequel. Our model of work is the meeting of the family and introduction of ourselves and what we are doing and what we are going to do in these 2 to 3 hours that we are seeing them. We take an intake about what happened, generally from the family or the caregivers that come, or the police officer or the social worker. And during that time, the medical clowns are sitting or playing or turning around with the medical clown, and the medical clown is interventioning with them at a specific way, especially for every child, if they are Arabic, if they are Ethiopian, if they are Christian, if they are religious or non-religious. Every part get its a special need. The medical clown studied here in the creative art therapy, and this helps a lot to make her very expertise. Laboratory tests are done also because we are under the ground of the hospital. And it is very important because we can see in the urine, for example, if there is semen or if there are drugs in the blood, if there is alcohol and how much alcohol. And we have forensic kids, we have medication, we have vaccination, everything under the ground of this place. And the social worker is intervening with the community to find a solution for every case, especially, and we contact the laboratory. We have a good contact with all the police stations around the north of Israel, and it is very, very important to have a contact immediately when we need it, and we can send them by email or by fax the first report in order to act very, very efficiently and quickly. And also there is a trial. The trial is one of the difficulty that we have to go through, because in the trial you can stand there and they try to tell you that you are not, especially in forensic medicine, that you are you didn't write it in the right way, and they try to make you feel stupid on the, that court, and it is very, very difficult to stand and 1 hour or 2 hours and be interrogated by somebody that got a million shekel to let somebody go out of jail. That's another difficulty. The patients have a lot of inhibitions. You are all of you are therapists, and you know that how the abuse influences the patients. They feel guilty, they feel shame, they are confused, and a lot of times they don't disclose, they don't wish to disclose, they don't know how to disclose, they try to disclose, to tell, but nobody is seeing or understanding that they are being abused. When they come, they are very ashamed to expose their body, especially the parts where have been abused, and they want privacy. The parents are sometimes disappointed from the social and the legal systems, and they are afraid of a judicial attitude of the staff. There is a special issue in the Arabic population, which is called the family honor. The family honor is when a girl was raped, the family must, her brothers or a father has to kill somebody who raped her, or a woman who had a sexual relation, she will be killed because she was not married before and she did it out of marriage. And there is another thing that is called in Arabic fadiha, which if somebody of an Arabic village will know that this girl is not a virgin, it's for the family, it's a very, very bad thing. And she will not marry, and her sisters will not marry, and we see it every day. I am a gynecologist, girls come to me and tell me, check if I am still a virgin, and if not, it will be a terrible things for me, and my husband will divorce me immediately at the first night after marriage. There are sometimes acute cases, but most of the cases are not acute. The children and a patient who have been sexually abused, it takes time for them to have the courage to go to the police. And as you know, most of them will take years and or 20 years to tell somebody about the abuse. The abuse has a lot of morbidity on the life of a patient. There will be a lot of educational problems. There will be people with special needs, aggressive, sexualized behavior, and a lot of re-victimization. I see a lot of girls who have been gone to the streets and having a lot of sexual relations with anybody that will give them food or drugs or anything, and then it will be a terrible case for that a lot of trauma and re-trauma and re-trauma for them. They have also chronic problems, medical problems, and we see them, these girls' risky behavior. We see them at our center, and we have to speak with them, and they have a lot of behavioral problems and educational problems. They shout, they don't want to enter, they don't want me to tell them what to do. And it's some of the difficulties of our our staff is to treat them and with and understand that they have been abused for a lot of times, and they don't want to take out their clothes, and they don't want me to see the scars that they have on their hands, because they self-inflicted injuries that they made. And I understand, because I have a lot of experience, that I see that they have suffered a lot and they don't want to take it out. So I understand, and I tell them, you are right, you don't be, I understand your case, and I will not look. And generally we try to do it a very, very delicately, by understanding, by not looking, and trying to make a very good bond before the examination. The staff is exposed to family hardship. Therefore, the process of exposure of the secret and examination will be very complex. Teamwork and consultation during the visit helps us to regulate our emotions and frustrations in order to be professional and calm. Because if I hear a case that makes me mad and I can't contain it, I wouldn't be calm and I wouldn't be professional to examine and to take all what I need to do and document and give the treatment. Because so the consultation between the staff is very important to regulate our emotions. For example, a mother of 7 years old brought to the center to be checked after she found her boyfriend in bed with her girl. It was not the first time that it happened. And she told the daughter that the boyfriend is ill and he is intensive care unit, and we can't go to see him, but he was arrested because of that case. For me, it was terrible that the mother lies to her daughter instead of telling her, you have been abused and he is sitting in jail for that. Nobody can touch you. Another case was a mother who brought her 10 years old girl who was raped by her 17 years old cousin. And after the rape, she was bleeding. She told her sisters that her cousin did something bad for her and she is bleeding. Then she called the mother, and the mother told her not to tell anybody about this case. And she told you got your menstruation. It's the first menstruation. Don't be afraid. And she didn't want to take her to any doctors, but because the bleeding continued for 5 days, the doctor, the pediatrician, told her, you have to go to hospital because she's bleeding. She came unwillingly to our center and told the girl, this is a menstruation, it's normal. I couldn't stand it. It was something that I couldn't do it. It was very difficult for me to see that she is lying and she is not supporting her. She is not willing to hear that, and she wants to make this a secret. I couldn't understand it, because I know that she is a Muslim and she wants not to have a murder on the honor of the family, and not to have this problem of marrying the children later in life. I could understand it. But I couldn't stand the fact that she lied to the child, and the child couldn't tell what happened to her. So these are some of the difficulties that the staff get. And in this case, I told the mother, you can't lie to your child. I want you to get in the examination room with the child. I want you to give her a hand and look into her eyes and tell her, it's good that you told me what happened to you. And it will never happen again. And the boy the cousin will pay for it. I want you to tell her. I want you to look in her eyes. It was difficult for her. It was very difficult for her, but then she did it, and then she told the girl that it was not forbid, it was forbidden to do these things. These cases are very difficult to explain because children who are not supported by her caregivers, it will be very difficult, and we all know the problems that will be later in life for long life if they don't get the support from their families. There will be mental health problems, will be aggression, eating disorders, sexualized playing, depression, anxiety, somatization, a lot of difficulty, dissociation, disbelief in people, and behind the behavioral changes may appear years late, years before a disclosure. We see the patient for the first time, but sometimes we see him after lots of assault and all kind of the assault. When they have a disbelief, we can't. It will be difficult for us because they deny and they don't want to tell us what happened to them. The staff is exposed to deal with a lot of difficulties. For example, adolescents who have been sexually abused wouldn't like to enter the center, wouldn't like to have eye contact with us. They are depressed, they are sitting and without looking at us. They don't want to be examined, they don't want to be undressed, they are scared, sometimes they are crying, they are hiding, and sometimes they denied, nothing happened to me, nothing happened to me, leave me alone. We never check with the force, as I told you before, so we have to be creative to find a way to approach to every patient in a different way, and the medical clowns helps us a lot. There was a mother of a 10 years old girl who came to the center with her daughter, and she tells us that the child saw a horse going above another female horse. When the daughter saw the horse above the other horse, she told her friend that was beneath her, this is like my grandfather doing to me. The friend went to her mother and told her, you know, today we saw the horses, she told me that the grandfather is doing the same. So this, to make the short story, that this story went to the social services, and the social services called the mother and told her, we suspect that your father is assaulting your daughter. She told them it's a lie. Nothing happened. It's not true. It's not true. But there was a child investigation, and the child told the child investigator about molesting by her grandfather lots of time. The social services asked the mother to bring the daughter to examination, to medical examination at our center, and she didn't want to. But they told her, if you don't take them, we have to take her. So she came to the center and she was very aggressive. She told, it's a lie, nothing happened to her, but you can examine her and you will see that nothing happened. And it was very difficult to deal with a mother. She didn't want to enter the examination room. So her sister, the sister's mother, the aunt of the daughter, entered to the examination room, and in the examination room, the child showed me with her finger where it happened and what happened, and I took the pictures. During that, the speaking of the child, I saw that the sister of the mother was crying, and I understood that a big, very big secret was there in this family about the grandfather who was molesting the child. Sometimes there will be no signs. There are non-specific signs. For example, there will be vaginal discharge, irritating, sometimes headache, anxiety, lot of kinds of signs that are non-specific. If a girl has a bleeding or she's pregnant, this is signs of sexual abuse. But most of the time, there will not be physical signs. 96% of the cases have no special signs. And this is very difficult for the medical system to understand what happens. If the child doesn't tell and you don't have any signs, what can you do? What can you do? You have to be creative in order to understand what happened. So this is one of the dilemma that most children don't have any medical findings, and because of non-damaging assault, you have sometimes they put a finger, sometimes they use lubricants, sometimes there is anal injury and or oral sex, and it will never leave signs, especially because children, it takes time for them to come to be checked if ever. So when they come after time, the time is a problem. There will be a complete healing of all the injuries and we will not see anything. Sometimes the puberty masks all the changes that of the hymen. So and superficial injuries heal very, very quickly. Medical clowns help the victim and his family to feel normal and happy, to feel a child again in this abnormal situation. By humor, laughter, and by playing, they are strengthening the children to feel better, to feel they are having control on this situation, and this helps us a lot. Even us, when we see the child is laughing and the child is sending bubbles and making all kinds of jokes and all kinds of things during the and play and make theater and all kinds of competitions on the bed. So it helps also us as a staff to do the examination better, to do the examination, to concentrate on the examination and not have to speak to the child and telling we are just finishing, stay calm, open the legs and be relaxed. The medical clowns do all this for us. It's normal to be normal. Dr. Nancy Kellogg's from the California, she told this sentence that is very important. But if the medical examination is normal, it doesn't tell you that nothing happened. So you have to remember this. And sometimes the parents, when I tell them everything is normal, they hug me. They are so happy that like nothing happened. And it is difficult for me to tell them, I don't say that nothing happened, but I don't see any signs of assault. So you have to be treated, the family has to be treated, and the child treated by our therapy or all kinds of therapy in order that the secret will be gone out. Thank you. Thank you very much.